Talk about European nights like no other, and this past week those were one of the best European nights when it comes to football. Barcelona defeating Liverpool by 3-0 at the Cathedral in Camp Nou, and then Tottenham losing by 1-0 to a young side of Ajax Amsterdam that travelled all the way to London to defeat Tottenham at their new home ground, and then Arsenal defeating Valencia by 3-1 in the Europa League, and then Chelsea getting a 1-1 draw away to enter Frankfurt of Germany. Those were the best nights in European football. Do you agree or not? Joining us here to discuss that is Ronnie Aloyo and George Omondi. Ronnie, it's been long, man, for you coming here on the touchline. Where have you been hiding, man?
A lot of things to do, but yeah. Nice to be back on the show. Mm-hmm. It's even greater and better.
Yeah.
You're on DSTV now, and it's fantastic.
Wow, perfect, Maze. George, welcome back from home. Welcome to the touchline.
Thank you so much.
Well, big European night between Barcelona and Liverpool. Did you expect that match to go the way it did?
Well, probably the greatest football match of the week. Liverpool, they are now like one of the top sides in English football and in global football, going to play against Barcelona, top side by any standard. So for me, the scoreline does not really reflect how the match was, because Liverpool deserved maybe 3 goals.
Yes.
Barcelona probably deserved more. Mm-hmm. But then Liverpool came into the match, pushed themselves to the limit, but then Barcelona and Messi showed them what the true limits are.
Yeah. Well, George, from your point of view watching Lionel Messi, there was a video that has been trending all over the internet where Lionel Messi promises the Barcelona fans that this time round we could not be able to give you the Champions League, we manage the Copa del Rey and the La Liga, but we promise you we are going to give you the Champions League. Is this the time that now people are seeing the ultimate how good Messi is in football?
Well, Messi has been good. There's no, we can't argue about that. He's been good and consistent all along.
Yeah.
But I think what pained them was losing to Roma in the last eight last season.
Yes.
After taking a commanding 4-1 lead. So that they lost in the quarters.
Yes.
So by him saying that they are bringing back the trophy to Nou Camp, he knew what he was talking about. And again, he was agitated by being ranked fifth in the Ballon d'Or,
yes,
knowing so well that he won the La Liga and the Copa del Rey.
Yeah.
So coming to this season, he has shown the world what he's made of. So far, he's reminded the world what he's made of. He's so far the top scorer in Europe, and they're doing good so far. They're headed for a treble, mm-hmm, which means he's keeping his promise.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, big match there for Barca and Liverpool. What were you going to say?
Certainly, yeah. You got to congratulate Messi for the effort he put in, really. He came out very, very strongly, mm-hmm, and just stood out and gave Barca some comfortable leads and goals going back to Anfield in the coming week. But
yes,
you also got to congratulate the entire Barcelona team. If you look at how the entire defense stood up against Liverpool fast attack line,
yes,
I think that's something that's worth commendable, because you probably would have thought that the first attacking Liverpool force will go against Barcelona, but then the defensive pairing, the center backs were very good, including Piqué was outstanding on the night, mm-hmm, and also one of probably the best goalkeeper now in the world,
yes,
Ter Stegen, was also very outstanding. So mm-hmm, even for Liverpool, if you go beyond the Liverpool role, there's Ter Stegen who's behind,
yes,
it and is doing phenomenal. Mm-hmm. So I think the entire Barca team was phenomenal on the night, and they deserve to win.
The dominance of Barcelona from that night, it gives them an upper chance to go ahead and win this trophy come May at the Metropolitano.
Sure, definitely. Because first of all, by putting three past the second most expensive keeper,
yes,
and the most expensive defender, mm-hmm, who has been lauded as the best so far in the EPL, mm-hmm, in fact winning the player of the season,
yes,
it's a big statement. And now that they've reached the semi, they have one foot in the finals, I don't think they are going to bottle it like they, yeah, did in the quarterfinals last season.
Yeah.
So going into the finals, of which I expect them to go through, mm-hmm, I don't think neither Ajax nor Spurs stand any chance of beating, mm-hmm, Barcelona in the finals.
Do you see any chance of Liverpool getting a comeback? We have seen Roma did it against this Barcelona side last season in the quarterfinals. Do you see a Liverpool side that is actually capable of scoring against Barcelona?
Well, Alisson Becker was part of the team that pulled an upset against Barcelona in the past season. Okay. And I think they'll draw some inspiration from that contest. But then this one is a whole different ballgame. 3-0 going back to Anfield, Liverpool need to score 4 past a messy Barcelona, and it's not possible.
Yeah.
They don't have any chance to get past Barcelona in this one. I think that's done and dusted.
Yeah.
Personally, I believe they can put 3 past Barca. Uh-huh. But considering that Barca will be chasing an away goal, it will make it quite difficult for them.
Yeah.
So it means, if anything, they have to calculate like 5 goals and above.
Uh-huh. Although you also got to fault Pep Jurgen Klopp, because he made some costly and unnecessary tactical mistakes by like pushing out Trent Alexander-Arnold out of this, and also Bobby Firmino. I think that cost them.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, the question I'm struggling with Liverpool is, will this side go down as one of the best teams not to win a trophy? Because it has been 4 years now since Jurgen Klopp took over at Liverpool. He has been improving season in, season out. But we are not seeing that result at the end of the day. We are not seeing that trophy. Can it be a scenario like that?
Well, it's just too early to speak because the season has too much to go. They have really some great chance to win the Premier League. And you can see Klopp has put in the work. He's like brought in the players he needs. He's instilled the tactical and the philosophy that he needs into that team. So, well, it's just too early to speak, to be honest, because we have like two crunch ties that are going down in the next two weeks, and it's just too early to speak, in my opinion. But he's done some work, to be honest, and you got to give him credit for that.
If there's one team that you'll talk about it putting some work and coming up, has got to be the Ajax boys, because for the first time since 1996, they're actually appearing in the knockout stages of Europe's elite competition, and they defeated Tottenham away from home by 1-0 as they head on to the second leg next week. How good was Ajax Amsterdam, George?
Well, this side is quite good. Right now, there's no doubt about it. They beat our defending champions, Real Madrid. In fact, three-time defending champions, Real Madrid, at the Bernabeu.
Yeah.
They again beat Ronaldo's Juventus.
Yeah.
At Turin,
yes,
which means they are not here for circus. They know what they want. Mm-hmm. They are not here for rehearsals. Mm-hmm. So they have the guts of going all the way to the finals. But the question is, if they meet either Barca or Liverpool, can they hold it? Because they don't have experience.
Yes,
they are so good. They can run for 90 minutes. They can take on big players. Mm-hmm. But the question is, will they make it past? Spurs then go ahead and beat the Giants in Liverpool or Barcelona.
Mm-hmm.
Probably it's a 50-50 affair, depending on how they show up in the finals, because the final has no rehearsal. It's only 90 minutes or 120.
Mm-hmm.
So depending on how they wake up on that day, if they reach the finals, then we may see them winning the title after for the first time since 95-96.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ronnie, this team was the team that was in the Europa League with Manchester United in 2017, and Manchester won 2-1 in that final. And people right now, they have wrote Manchester United off, but Ajax has gone, been improving and improving and improving. It's now 12 matches in the Champions League, actually, and they haven't lost anyone. From your side, when you see an Ajax team, what improvements did they do that makes them a good team that they are so far?
Well, to be honest, Ajax in a way are upstarts, and it's a big surprise for them to get this far in the competition. The side they played in the semi-finals, Tottenham, Ajax has just a third. The budget is a third of Spurs' wage bill, so it's just insane. But I think they really have got it right from the recruitment, right from the technical department, because they have really right guys in the technical department.
Yeah.
I think that's working correctly for them. Mm-hmm. Getting in like young players and very, very talented stars has worked for them. For me, that makes the difference.
Former players coming in to help their team and work on perfectly. How do you think Edwin van der Sar's impact has been to the Ajax boys? Because he was there. He was the last man to win that Champions League with Ajax, left, went to Manchester United and won another Champions League with Manchester. But he was back. He's the CEO. He's the one running Ajax. Is he the best brain for Ajax at the moment?
Sure, probably. Because with such brains and experience behind the scenes, it shows that they have groomed the kids into what they want. Like the philosophy that they've always had.
Yes.
They groom good players, then make them champions, then probably sell them. Like as I'm speaking right now, 8 of them are in the market.
Yes.
From Dijon to Delete.
They
are guys on, probably on their way out. In fact, Dijon has already signed a pre-contract with Barcelona.
Yes.
Delete is believed to be on his way to one of the giants, either Barca, Madrid, or even
Bayern Munich.
Sure.
Yes.
So, going by what has happened so far, they have groomed a very young side that is capable of winning the championship and maybe conquering Europe.
Yes.
Because they come at this at the back of losing in the Europa finals against Manchester United, just like Rooney has pointed out.
Yes.
So, if fate falls on their side and they win the title, actually it will be an overachievement. Because so far they've achieved so far by reaching the semi-finals, it's an achievement.
Yes.
So by winning the title, we'll at least bring back the glory days at Ajax, which is known to produce some of the best players from Kano Nwankwo, Seedorf, name them, Kluivert.
Yeah,
sure.
I want to disagree with George.
Yeah,
like he's given Ajax some proper plaudits, but then I think for them, this might just be it. They carry the advantage against Tottenham from the first leg.
Yes.
But I think they've really overachieved. They've done well. Mm-hmm. And I think that's just it. I really have my reservations if they're really going to get past Tottenham in the second leg. Yeah. Looking at it, in the first leg, Ajax had a perfect chance to go for the jugular, but they went for the win.
Yeah.
Tottenham lacked so many of their key players. Mm-hmm. And even the injury that affected them, the Jan Vertonghen injury,
yes.
So they had to bring in Sissoko and reorganize a bit. I think that affected them. But for me, Ajax messed up a chance to kill the game totally, and that will haunt them in the second leg.
You are saying it might be a Barcelona-Tottenham final.
Looks like it. There's every chance that Barcelona are going to meet Tottenham.
Yeah.
And again, for Spurs, it will be a big achievement.
Yeah.
Barcelona have like an outright advantage, barring any natural calamity. They're into the final.
Yes.
And Ajax, in the second leg, we are more likely going to see Son coming back into the team and maybe Van Togen. I don't know how bad the injury is.
Yeah.
And you could tell that once Spurs made that substitution, bringing in Moussa Sissoko and playing four in the midfield, because they started with three at the back, then they had to bring in Sissoko and play four in the midfield. It changed the entire game, and Spurs had some real chances to also like punish Ajax. So for me, I'm sure Spurs and Mauricio Pochettino have learned some lessons from that, and they're going to hurt Ajax.
He may have a point,
yes.
Spurs can easily go through.
Yes.
But going by what these young kids have done, to Real Madrid and Juve.
Their road to where they are at the moment. Yeah.
They have the advantage because so far they have an away goal. They are going home just chasing to push on up on that. But talking of Son coming back and maybe Kane is also on his way to recovery.
Yes.
He may show up, but Spurs are perennial disappointing.
Another point we are learning is that the Dutch Football Federation had to postpone the matches of Ajax to go on a rest so that they could prepare for Tottenham. It was actually a good move for them. What do you think of that?
Yeah, it was. It was. I think.
And did it offer them an advantage?
Yes, it did. Yes, it did. Because there's so much pressure coming into these young boys. It's a young team, to be honest.
Yes.
With the exception of a few experienced or older players like Klassi and Huntelaar. So it was a good thing for the federation, and one of the talking points this week has been the Dutch Football Federation has done quite a lot in helping the Netherlands football or the Dutch soccer move forward, because you can see like how much they're helping Ajax, and also after that down when Dutch football went down at some point, then they went back and started like doing it all again.
Yes.
They moved away from the likes of the former Man United coach, Mr. Van Gaal, now developed a whole new system of football that we are now seeing. So for sure, you can see the fruits of what the federation is doing there, and just not at club level, but also at international level, Holland will be like one of the teams to watch.
Yes. Maurizio Sarri also came in to say that they actually, England FA also need to come up with such a mechanism to help this team play in the Europa League. Do you think it affected them playing Frankfurt and drawing 1-1 away in Germany? Because for them, they are not in any rest category. You play the Europa League, the Premier League, back to the Europa League.
Sure, he has a point, but the Dutch Federation didn't only help Ajax. They postponed all the matches. So it was like, it wasn't Ajax alone, it was all the matches. So they are going to reschedule their timetable, which basically favors the Ajax. So the English side, if they dare do that, you know, these are side that always play back-to-back matches. They are used to it.
Yes.
So I don't know why they should tamper with their tradition, because we've seen United win the treble in 1999. And we've seen the likes of Kina Chelsea win the EPL and go ahead and win the Champions League
in
the same season. Same to Manchester United.
Yeah.
So I don't think it's very much necessary, because these are seasoned players who are capable of playing after every 48 hours, like FIFA rules speculate. But if they get that chance of maybe resting, it may be an advantage.
Mm-hmm.
But the Ajax resting doesn't necessarily give them an upper hand,
because
players, despite the fact that you may be fresh, and maybe you've rested, the players who has played just the previous match can easily come up and go past you and even beat you. Let's give an example of Gormaya against Barkane.
Yes.
They reached on the same, so the top players reached on the same day and played hours after landing.
Yes.
So we've seen teams get pummeled like 7-1 and they're rested. So depending on how you show up on the match day, it was what matters. It's not all about resting or maybe having an advantage. It's all about how you show up on the material.
Even the winter breaks that the EPL is planning to introduce might not help that much.
It may, but it's always a 50-50 affair.
Yeah.
Because even the Germans have the winter break.
Mm.
But look at how Bayern Munich were dealt with by Liverpool, right?
Mm.
It's all about how you show up on the big day that matters. Tactically, strength, and maybe how you come up with the substitutions and the whole team setup.
Yeah.
Sure.
Big one that is happening there in Europe and everything that is happening. Arsenal also managed to win by 3-1 against Valencia, actually coming back from 1-0 to win that one. Ronnie, it looks it might be a Europa affair where it is an English affair in the Europa League.
In the Europa League, to be honest, both ties are away from getting done. Chelsea, again, 1-1. It's a very open match, open for either side. Arsenal, you could feel the sigh of relief when Pierre-Emerick Aubameyang scored the third goal, the Emirates. There was every sign that probably there was a fourth defeat looming for the Gunners, especially after going three straight losses in the domestic league.
Yes.
So for me, very, very tight one again for Arsenal going to Spain. To be honest, if you look at that Arsenal team, it's in a bit of shambles at the moment. Aubameyang and Lacazette are the only shining lights in a very dark and gloomy Arsenal side. As the Valencia team coach put it after the match, the two made the difference in the night. And when you have that caliber of players, then
that's Aubameyang and Lacazette.
Yeah, they're able to hurt you anytime. So.
Yes.
I think it's really far away from getting done.
Yeah.
Valencia know they have like a chance in this one.
Mm-hmm.
Arsenal's defensive shambles and the team doesn't really look strong.
Mm.
They just might need a dose of luck to sneak it through.
Well, what do you think, George, in the return leg, because it will be in Valencia?
Arsenal have an upper hand. Like, they have one leg in the finals.
Yes.
But going by their record in Spain, they still have a lot to do.
Mm-hmm.
Aubameyang and Laka may be in good form.
Yes.
But going by how they've bottled their matches previously,
mm-hmm.
let's go back to last season. They lost to Atletico Madrid in the Europa League.
Yes.
Was it in the semifinals? Sure. So the record in Spain will haunt them unless they show up and kill off the match. But by maybe getting an away goal, they'll be safe.
Yeah.
But again, we have to point out that this is Emre Unai's side. It's not Wenger's side. It's a side that maybe has something new or has something to prove to the world, because Arsenal have been known to be perennial bottlers when it comes to big matches.
Yes.
Away from reaching the Champions League finals in 2005 or 2006, they are yet to reach there again. So this is a very big chance for them. But again, the record against Spanish sides will haunt them. Yeah. You even remember what Sevilla did to Liverpool in the finals, coming back from behind to beat them 3-1 in the finals.
Yeah.
So they have to show up, maybe just get an away goal and they are safe.
Although Aubameyang like pointed after the contest that, look, we are humans and coming into this match on the back of a 3-match defeat, we are bound to be nervous. And
yes.
Well, at the start of the match, you could see Arsenal were showing the nerves and they conceded a very early goal from Valencia. So it just also depends with how well the older players in the team are able to just put the acts together and like calm the nerves. I know losing three straight matches is not easy.
Yes.
And with all this pressure for top four, pressure for the Europa League, pressure to qualify for Europe, then you really have to get your top players to just calm the nerves and just do their thing. But it's also commendable that, well, they say the best form of defense is attack. Mm-hmm. Arsenal tried that out against Valencia, yeah, and probably going to the next matches, that's what they might do. Just go out and attack and see what happens.
Well, still hanging out here with Ronnie Aloyo and George Omondi to discuss everything that was the reactions from the European leagues. On Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, we'll be still be having those matches as Liverpool will be travelling. No. The first match will be actually Ajax welcoming Tottenham, and then Liverpool going to play against Barca at Anfield, and then we'll be having Valencia versus Arsenal, and then Chelsea will be playing Frankfurt at the Stamford Bridge. We'll switch gears now to the English Premier League, where we'll be having many matches this afternoon. But yesterday it was a 2-0 win at Merseyside for Everton on Friday night football. Our early kickoff match today will be FC Bournemouth versus Tottenham Hotspur. In this match, Song Mi-hoon is the one who has scored many goals against FC Bournemouth. Then at 5, we'll be having two matches. West Ham United will be welcoming Southampton in London. Then Wolverhampton Wanderers will be playing already relegated side Fulham, as Cardiff City also welcomes Crystal Palace at 7:30. At 9:45 PM, it will be a big match that might be a decider of the season, and that will be Newcastle FC versus Liverpool. How will that match go? Those are the major matches that we'll be having on the English Premier League here today. I don't know where to start off this one, but I'm going to start with Everton. 2-0 win against Burnley. Ronnie, Marco Silva and Everton, it seems that he has brought some kind of strength to an Everton side that he has told them, you guys are actually good to go and play in Europe. And that's what they are chasing at the moment.
Yeah, sure, that's true. But for me, Everton has not really lived up to the potential or the billing that they were touted to at the start of the season.
Yes.
They looked very promising. They brought in very good players, right from the defense all the way to the attack, where they have Richarlison. They have a couple of, like, Yerry Mina, who's not really played for the better part of the season. So for me, Everton, they've been blowing hot and cold, and that's the problem with them. Mm-hmm. They are a very good side, to be honest. Marco Silva is a very good coach, but they've showed some inconsistency, although really late at the season they're really showing some energy and some promising play. But yeah, they probably might just qualify for the Europa League. It just depends on how they perform in the final two matches.
Well, Everton winning yesterday there by 2-0 against Burnley. The first match that is going to start off the day will be FC Bournemouth versus Tottenham. It seems that Eddie Howe cannot beat Mauricio Pochettino.
Yeah, that's what everyone is saying.
Mm-hmm.
But remember, Spurs are chasing the top four.
Yeah.
And I don't see how they're going to bottle this. They're going to let this one go. Because if they lose, the chasing pack is on their neck.
Yeah.
Finishing on the top four may help them maybe rebuild next season, because going by what's happening in the Champions League, their chances are slim right now. But if they slip, they can still afford to lose one match and still go, make it in the top four.
Yes.
Going by how the other three sides have been playing, like no one wants the top four. It's either you are losing, drawing. Like Arsenal lost the last three matches in a row. United lost two and drew. Then Chelsea come up winning one and maybe drawing two. Mm-hmm. It's like a ping pong that we may have to go to the end of the season to see who is going to take the top four positions.
Well, that game is currently underway, 15 minutes into that game, and it is still 0-0 in that match between FC Bournemouth and Tottenham Hotspur. West Ham versus Southampton. Before we go to West Ham versus Southampton, I'm going to ask, in the Tottenham setup at the moment, Mauricio Pochettino has got experience, has got good players, but it doesn't seem to hack it when it matters most.
Yeah, like what they did against West Ham United at home.
Yes.
Losing their first match in the new stadium, that is quite a blunder, and they now opened it up for other teams to now probably look at their chances of finishing top three or top four. So for me, Tottenham bottled it when it matters most. Mm-hmm. However, for this one, I think Bournemouth are safe into the season, and I think Tottenham will win this one for sure.
Well, West Ham versus Southampton there will be coming at 5 p.m. Then we'll be having Wolves versus Fulham. Fulham is already relegated. Wolves is playing to cement their place in the top eight, in the top eight of the table at the moment. What has impressed you for Wolves this season?
Their recruitment. Mm-hmm. Well, at the start of the season, there was discussion around Jorge Mendes' involvement in the team. You could see what he did with the team. He brought in very experienced players. Well, the manager is very good, Nuno Espirito Santo, very good manager. Brought in a couple of good players from Portugal, like the Portuguese goalkeeper,
yes.
Jimenez. So for me, the recruitment was done right. They brought in the good number of players, and they've had a very good run in the season. And kudos to Wolves for the run they've had so far.
Well, a big match there will be coming also, Cardiff versus Crystal Palace at 9:30. But the biggest match of the day will be at 9:45 p.m. and that is Newcastle FC versus Liverpool. And Benitez has come out to say he's not going to do Liverpool any favours. Do you think this is the match that might determine Liverpool's season or not?
Definitely. Because Rafa may have some bitterness because the manner in which he was released by Liverpool.
Yes.
So with him, he's playing for his mid-table position as usual. Mm. So there's no way he can maybe put up a second string side to do Liverpool any favor. He's in business. Mm-hmm. He's also here to defend his job. Going by the other fixture that may easily determine this league, mm-hmm. it's City versus Leicester on Monday.
Yes.
You see, Leicester also have Brendan Rodgers, a former Liverpool coach, who has said that he's going to play his part in the title challenge, mm-hmm. which probably means he's looking forward to holding City to a draw or beating them.
Yes.
We all know that Leicester beat City in the first leg. But do you think Pep Guardiola will sit back and maybe watch them play around? Not definitely. I'm sure Pep has a game plan. Yes. And as it stands right now, whoever wins, they both need to win their matches. But if Liverpool wins both and City wins both of their matches, we may end up having a situation whereby Liverpool are ending up with 91 points, the highest tally ever for a team to finish second.
Yes.
United came in close with 89 points in 2012-2011 season.
Yes.
But didn't win the title. So it's all about winning your matches. Whoever draws, any draw or any slip, mm-hmm. you're done.
And then that one is, Liverpool have lost to Barcelona. They're supposed to play Barcelona next week, and they're meeting a crunch match against Newcastle. That might determine how the league goes for them. What kind of priorities will Klopp have for this match?
Well, that's now the beauty of football, that it comes to now such breathtaking moments.
Yeah.
It's interesting that, as George puts it, that the last two managers to come to a whisker to ending Liverpool's title drought are now having like a direct impact on what the title will look like, or rather who wins the title.
Yes.
It's very interesting. Well, Brendan Rodgers, we can see how close he came with the Chelsea match, the Steven Gerrard slip, Rafa Benitez as well. But now, well, pundits have it that Rafa Benitez will want one over his former side.
Yeah.
And, well, both contests are honestly going to go down to the wire. But in my honest opinion, Liverpool also won this so badly.
Yes.
They might just sacrifice this for the Champions League. Looks like it. Man City, after falling out from the Champions League, also won this so bad.
Yes.
But then that's football. It's won by millimeters. It's won by very tiny margins. And I think that tiny margin is the Aguero goal last weekend.
Yeah. Well, it's going to be a determining factor in those matches. On Sunday, we'll be having three matches on the card. At 4 p.m., we'll be Chelsea versus Watford, and then Huddersfield Town versus Manchester United, and then at 6:30 will be Arsenal versus Brighton Hove. Looking at the Sunday matches, Chelsea, Man United, Arsenal, I'm inclined to say that a lot has changed in England at the moment, because at the top level is Man City, Liverpool, Tottenham fighting for that one. Chelsea, Man United, Arsenal are now back into the pecking order. What went wrong for this side? Because they were the traditional rivals in the top four. Now they are not in the top four.
Well, for Chelsea, I think it's about the managerial changes. Mm. At some point, it didn't work for them. For Arsenal, that transition, Unai Emery is trying to rebuild a team that was in shambles when Arsene Wenger's era ended. Mm. For Man United, everything is completely wrong with that team, right from the management to the players. The managers now and the technical team don't know, like, they just can't put the team together. They're not the right people for the job.
Yeah.
The playing unit, the most expensive player is not playing. One of the most expensive midfielders, Paul Pogba, is not helping the team either.
Yes.
So for Man United, it's worse than we thought it could be. Looking at how the season might end, I think Chelsea might end in the top four. Arsenal and United might not get into the top four.
Well, big one for Manchester United there, and Arsenal plus Chelsea, as they are going to play in the tail end of this Premiership. Manchester City versus Leicester will be playing on Monday, and we'll be giving you results on the sports pages and other events that are happening here on Y254. Let's switch gears a bit to the Africa Cup of Nations, where two critical players who play in England will be missing out. That is Naby Keita of Liverpool will be missing out for Guinea, and then Manchester United will be missing out Eric Bailly. How bad will it be for Guinea missing Naby Keita? Also, the African continent missing those boys, because they have been watching them in England.
Well, it's a big blow. Naby Keita has been sensational for Liverpool since coming to the side this season. Going back even at the semi-finals against Barcelona, the moment he limped off, the match changed completely. And he has got his groove back. He's gotten his groove. He's scoring goals in terms, and he's good in creativity going up front. So Guinea are going to miss him big. You know,
yes.
Guinea is a good side that has always reached the quarterfinals, semis, quarters, semis,
yes.
Blowing hot and cold. They may not have the best of their during their days, like the Camaras, but Keita missing is a big blow. On the other hand, Sadio Mané missing for, is it Ivory Coast?
Ivory Coast.
Yeah, it's also another major blow.
Yes.
At the right back, he's always stood out. You saw, by the time you're playing for PSG and then you sign for Tottenham, it means you're a big player.
Yeah.
So they're going to miss him big. But we always know the West Africans always have a replacement for each and every player. As much as they may miss him, they still have someone who will fill in his space.
Yes.
But it won't be the same. So at the end of the day, at the end of the day, Africa will miss their sons, but football has to be played.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, will Eric Bailly be missed in Ivory Coast?
Yeah, he sure will be missed. He's also not had a spectacular season at United. He's one of the players who reportedly went out,
yeah,
the so-called Spanish legend alongside De Gea and Mata.
Yeah.
So I think it's a big blow in terms of the player, but then Ivory Coast will certainly find a replacement going into the AFCON that's just about a month away.
Yes.
Yeah, my only problem is there's not enough hype. You can't feel the energy, you can't feel the vibe
going on to the Africa Cup of Nations.
Exactly. That's the biggest football tournament in the continent, and there's just not enough buzz and vibe around it.
Is this us who are making the mistake? You are not telling people what's actually happening?
Probably a collection of different factors, maybe the federations, maybe we, the sports writers and journalists.
Yes.
Yeah.
And probably marketing, because it's all about marketing. CAF, I don't think they're doing enough.
Yeah.
They have new sponsorship in total. They should be hyping everything right now.
Yeah.
But we all know that all African matches come after the Europa. Everything in Europe
is done.
Right now, we are looking at the tail end of Europe, which is the all the leagues and maybe the Champions League and the Europa League. Once we are done with that, is when everyone will go back to AFCON.
Yeah. Does Wanyama inspire confidence for you when we are going to AFCON? Because the first leg against Barcelona, no, against Ajax actually, when they played, people like, hey, Wanyama has really done the hit on second leg. He was a bit not there. Does it inspire confidence?
Well, he got some bashing this past week for his below par performance against Ajax. But then I don't think he does, honestly. He's more like Pogba, a good player, but turns up when he wants to turn up.
Yes.
But then when he doesn't want to turn up, then we are messed up. He's like the main man in our team. He's got the experience. He's got the personality. I just hope he does turn up on the day, because then everyone in that national team, everyone in this country will be looking up to him. But on a good day, he's surely a very good player. But then when he just doesn't want to turn up Pogba style, then he doesn't turn up.
Well, big matches that you are going to have, we appreciate you are going. You have had the last word here for the Touchline, according to Wanyama. Some also KPL match that will be happening this afternoon will be Vihiga United versus Chemelil as they try to get into the bottom half of the table. But they will also have FC Leopards versus Madare tomorrow, Posta versus Bandari, Kariobangi Sharks versus Kakamega Homeboys, Western Steamer versus Gorumia. Big matches in the Kenya Premier League that will be happening. Zoo versus Sony Sugar, Tusker versus Sofapaka, then KCB versus Mount Kenya, and then to finish up match there will be Ulinzi Stars versus Nzoia Sugar. If you're still enjoying the English Premier League, 25 minutes gone between FC Bournemouth and Tottenham Hotspur. That match is still currently underway, and we'll be seeing how the results will be coming, and you can get the results on our Facebook and Twitter social media pages. Thanks a lot, George, for coming here on Y254. Thanks a lot, Ronnie Aloyo. We really appreciate everything that we have done. That's all for us here on the Touchline here on Y254. Maxwell Asika could not make it, but hey, we have done it and we have enjoyed it. For everyone who made this production come to this tail end, tunasema asante sana and good afternoon.